It is from Psalm 118, reading verses 1 and 2 and 19 through 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, the righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. For God's steadfast love endures forever. Our epistle lesson for this Lord's Day is from Philippians, the second chapter, reading verses 5 through 11. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has also highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Here ends the scripture for this Lord's Day. May it be a blessing to all of our hearts. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and His Son, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. It's Palm Sunday and Holy Week begins as Jesus enters the holy city of Jerusalem. The testimony of all four of the Gospels make it abundantly clear. He knows what it is that he's doing. It is a deliberate act. It's an intentional act. He's going there on purpose, not only to celebrate the coming Passover, but with the completion of his earthly ministry clearly in his mind. Jesus knows that it's all coming together, you see. It's coming to a head. Jesus knows the prophecies, and he knows the religious leaders, and he knows the political situation and reality in all of its complexity. And Jesus knows that soon he will die. Jesus knows the darkness of the heart of humankind in its sin. And Jesus knows that he will be crucified. Jesus will be murdered. He will die. And still, despite this reality, he marches on. He marches on into this city that is renowned for killing the prophets. How does he do such a thing? What sustains him? And as we watch his march, dare we ask ourselves, where are we marching to on this Holy Week, on this Palm Sunday? Where are we marching to? Are we marching with Jesus? I think the best answer that comes to these questions, especially this question of how Jesus did this thing, this bold, faithful march to the cross, is given to us in Paul's letter to the Philippians, the second chapter, verses 5 through 11. Philippians chapter 2, 5 through 11, you see, is a lyric. It's a hymn. The Apostle Paul is writing to the Philippians, and he does so because he hopes that this letter that he's sending will assist them in growing in love and in knowledge and in insight. And in this second chapter, in the midst of all of his typical Pauline presentation and argumentation and doctrine, right here in the middle of the second chapter, he pauses to quote this lyric, this hymn. It would be as though I were to stop right now, right here in the middle of my sermon, and just belt out a chorus of Amazing Grace. Don't tempt me. You know, sometimes a song accomplishes more than a sermon. Perhaps a song will help these Philippians and us. Maybe it'll help them live into the worthiness of the gospel of Christ to which they are called. Maybe it will help them stand firm in one spirit. Maybe it will enable them to be of one mind and to love as Christ himself loved. Wow, that's a list of expectations, isn't it? But that's Paul. Paul has high hopes for the Philippian church and for us too. And so the hymn that Paul sings tells us ultimately that it is appropriate to worship Jesus Christ. It is appropriate to confess that he is Lord. It is appropriate to believe that every knee should bow and tongue confess that Jesus is the Lord to the glory of God the Father. The hymn celebrates. It celebrates Christ's incarnation. It celebrates his crucifixion. It celebrates Christ's exaltation. But at the heart of this hymn, at the quintessence, we discover that the character of Christ is that which this hymn declares. He emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. And the Son so loved the world that he emptied himself, humbled himself, became a servant for us, and obeyed. He was selfless in our selfish world. He was the consummate person for others. He looked to our saving interests above his very own life's breath. A distinguished theologian says that this was the shape of the engendering deed for Jesus. Now, what that means is that this selflessness, this servanthood, this humility, and this obedience formed the pattern and the shape of the entirety of Christ's life. He marched into Jerusalem because it was congruent with his character of selfless servitude, of his true humility, and of his total obedience. He does this because this man, this holy, selfless man, this Son of God, this Savior and Messiah, loved us purely. He does not look out for number one. He spends no energy protecting himself. He serves us and is completely clear, completely dedicated, completely focused. And I think the point is, if we hope to march with Jesus, we too must subscribe to this alternate ethic of selflessness and humility and service to others. What might it mean for you to embody this mind of Jesus? What crosses might you be called to take up? What might it mean for an entire congregation to embody this mind of Jesus? What crosses might it be called to take up? Might it even be called to risk itself, even to the point of death? What crosses might we be called to take up? And in the face of such opportunity, can we empty ourselves enough? You see, Palm Sunday really isn't about waving palms. By the end of the week, the palm wavers had simply gone away. Palm Sunday is about entering the city that murders the prophets and go with Jesus Christ all the way to the cross. And the only way to do it is to do it as Jesus does. He emptied himself. He humbled himself. He became obedient even unto death, even death on a cross. And sometimes a hymn is better than a sermon. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? No turning back, no turning back. Amen.